Okay, so welcome everybody to another session of Logics in Quarantena. On behalf of the Brazilian Logic Society and of the Logic Interest Group of the Brazilian Computer Society, I'd like to thank very much Professor Gabriel Scherer, who kindly accepted to give this talk and to talk about open access in programming language research. Gabriel, thank you very much.
Thank you. So thanks a lot for the invitation. Valeria suggested that I speak about open access, which is not strictly speaking a scientific topic, but it's a topic about how we work as a scientific community or as scientific communities. I'm glad that other people find it interesting. And yes, I'm going to talk about what I know, and I'm more of a programming languages researcher. And some of the things I will say are applied. This is a field that is fairly close to computer science logic, related in many ways. And some of the things I say apply to more broadly, and some are fairly specific. So I may say things that are not accurate in other domains. And feel free to interrupt me at any point with questions or with discussion. This is a topic that deserves discussion. So you can also interrupt or to just give your opinion at some point. That's fine with me. So yes, I will start by, okay, what do we mean by open access? And I will start with something to put in context about, okay, what it is that we do as researchers, and what is our job? And so this is an opinionated slide. I try to highlight when there are more opinions than just facts in the slide. So in my opinion, basically, I can describe the goal of public research, not research in private companies, as pick a problem of public interest, find out something new about it, and then let everyone know about what you found. The last part, letting everyone know, involves some peer review and so on, so it's also work, but it's part of our work. And so the opinion part is that if the part number two, so the third item, is not done well, then we are not doing our job well. It's part of our work. And there are several ways to not do this part well. Some people tend to err on the side of keeping their work as draft forever and never publishing it. That's not so good, even if the work is very good. And other ways to publish the work in some ways that make it difficult to access to other people. So this question of access to published research is what I'm going to talk about. So what normal people mean by open access is, the step where you let everyone know that should be free, in the sense that people should be able to access your work without paying anything, and you should be able to put your work out without paying anything. Of course, there is a problem that, it actually involves some material costs, and by which I mean the network access, the hosting, but also some works that happen during publishing. So picking a DOI for your paper and so on. So there is a bit of work, and of course someone has to pay for this work, but the costs involved should remain very small, negligible. Okay, question. So if we can host videos for free and have them reach a very large audience, why could we not host research papers for free? Or almost free, and I'm going to discuss this in slightly more details. So this is what normal people mean by open access. It's basically free. It's completely free to read, and it's basically free to publish. And then scientific editors, which are the people in charge of doing the actual publishing, have slightly different open access. They tend to distinguish various categories, including green open access, which means that they let you put your paper on archive, which I don't consider open access at all. It's just that you can put your copy of your work on archive. This is the same as not doing anything. And then there is gold open access, which is that means that you give to the publishers a lot of money, and then it's free for the readers of the work. And then there is something called diamond open access, which is what normal people call open access. So when I talk about open access, usually I mean diamond open access, otherwise I would be specific. Okay, a last, well, it's not the last opinion that is there, but one that is clearly opinionated is the following. So closed access journals or conference proceedings typically they work, so the ones that are not open access, by asking you to, as the author, to transfer the copyright of your work to them, or to give exclusive publishing agreement. So you did your work, and then you provide it to them for free, but then you are supposed to give them more than just letting them publish the work. You should transfer ownership of the research work that you did to them, or give an exclusive agreement that no one else is allowed to publish the work. And okay, opinion. So I believe that this is not ethical. Basically, I mean, taking something away from someone for free is that requires work on the side and that they cannot use anymore is called stealing in the normal world. And I think that opinion that this applies again in this case. And one opinion I have is that actors, institutions, publishers, and so on that do this are bad. So when you do something unethical, arguably you're doing something bad. But sometimes they may not notice because they worked in this framework for so long that they don't notice anymore than that asking a young PhD student to assign the copyright for their PhD work to them is not something that is morally okay. And we as researchers, we tend to, as well, to forget about this. Of course, some people are not of this opinion. They think that it's perfectly fine to ask to transfer copyright for free. And some people, deep down, they agree. And this is what most of us do. Deep down, we agree, but we, for the comfort of working in good condition, we tend to not think about this so often. And it's a perfectly fine thing to do. Okay. So then I'm going to speak a bit about why I think it matters, why it is useful to think about open access from them. Do you have some questions on what I already said?
No questions by now.
Okay. So it's worth saying a bit about why is the difference between open access and closed access important? First, I think that having readers pay for the work is bad. So most research institutions actually let you access the work. If you are a member of an institution, a researcher, a PhD student, and so on, you can access any research that is behind the paywall because they did already pay for access to the paper. So most people working in research do not feel any pain when they access closed access papers, for example. And so to them, it is a problem that in practice does not exist. So they may say, well, okay, what's the problem with that? Well, there are several problems. One is that students that are not yet at the PhD stage may not be part of an institution that has already access to this scientific content. So personal example, until my master's studies included, so before my PhD, I was part of an institution that did not have access to most computer science conference proceedings. It's not that they didn't have the money, it's that they didn't really know that computer science proceedings existed. So they would subscribe to math journals, but not computer science. And then the people that are not in the field don't have access. And I think that it's a failure of what I call point two, letting people know about our work. And then there is a common reply to that, which is, oh, it's okay because the papers are on our personal web pages anyway. But I think it's not such a good answer because, well, first, it's not always the case. So every once in a while, you will not find the papers. And I think some people noticed that during COVID when they were not using their institution proxy anymore. It's more work to find the paper. So you are not, because sometimes you have five institutional web pages that correspond to place you were before, and half of them are dead links and so on. So it's work. And the people that are outside our community typically don't know about how to look for the paper, how to find your webpage, and so on, which may include students or people that will be part of the community later. If they can engage with it and discover that it's an interesting field, but may not know about how to look for the papers that exist somewhere. So I think that it's not a good solution in the long term. And having the authors pay is also bad. So again, most researchers do not notice or do not think very often about the problem, because if you work at a rich research institution, you can pay author processing charges. This is the what we call the cost of publishing. Yes, is there a question?
Sorry, I wanted to interrupt a little bit, Gabriel, because I think, you know, even in the previous page, we have a problem because of this business that, you know, you say research and students working there typically have full access. That is already not quite true, right? Because, you know, it depends on whether the research institution has the access. And, you know, lots of places, particularly in kind of places in development as a college, don't have access to the scientific journals and proceedings. I think Brazil is particularly good because there was at some stage an attempt of getting all the university, the public universities part of situations where you could have access. But, you know, in lots of other places, I mean, I think would be good for to improve this, we need to have more sizes of communities that, you know, kind of the sizes of which institutions of higher education do have access and which ones don't.
Yes, yes. And I think, so it depends on the size of the institution, whether they are sort of focused on computer science or not, for example. It also depends on the research community. For example, in my field, I would say that a lot of publications are ACM, and I mean are published by ACM, and the subscription prices for ACM content are relatively low. So I think it could be on the order of $20,000 per year per institution, something like that, to get access to the digital library. So it's not part of, so for example, Elsevier, there are some institutions that just cannot afford to pay the prices. For ACM, it's a bit different. Of course, some people will not have the money, some institutions, but there are fewer of them. So it depends on what are the important publishers in your field and so on. But yes, already for, well, basically the idea is as soon as there is a cost, there is a barrier for entry that will make it harder for outsiders or for researchers in less well-funded institutions or less rich countries in particular to access the work. But I think it's even worse for offers pay in the sense that I know that the situation is not so good in large part of South America, for example. And I think that some APCs, author processing charts, that are commonly asked by journals or in our fields, could be $1,000 or two or three, would be very difficult to afford for the typical budget of some people in Argentina, for example, or other countries. So, yes.
Just to address another problem, here in Brazil, we have the government pays for this base. And sometimes it's possible that we use some governmental funding to pay the auto processing charge. But it's so the government is double paying it because they pay for the papers to be free for us and also for the open access.
Yes, yes. And sometimes there are, I mean, government try to put rules in place so that the publishers don't have double pay so that. If they ask for APCs, then the content is available to everyone instead of having this some hybrid journals or conference proceedings where you have to pay to publish for open access, but then some people don't pay, and so it's some of the work is closed access, so you have to pay on both types. So yeah, it's very complex and many bad situations exist. But I understand that I'm in front of an audience. I'm honor to be invited where this question of cost is something that is real, because when I talk to people for example in the US, in principle they agree, but in practice the personal costs or the salaries are high enough that and the way the expenses are handled that these costs are more closer to neglectable to them, so they agree, but it's harder to get them to do some meaningful effort in this direction because they have many other important things to care about. Okay, I understand that you are already convinced that this is important. So then, okay, what does open access or not look like in my subfield? So disclaimer, that depends a lot on the community. some parts, for example, of mathematics are excellent from an open access point of view. I understand that category theory, for example, is in a really good place. Their main journals are open access and Diamond open access, and everyone is happy. Some parts of computer science are only closed access. Sometimes more applied fields tend to be more closed, it depends. And my own field, which is programming languages or bordering on logic type theory, is sort of in the middle. There is some good and some bad. So what do I mean by good? I mean that it's completely free for readers. Sorry, I wrote authors, but I meant for readers. No, I cannot fix it easily. Can I? Maybe I can. Yes. Anyway, completely free for readers. And then the publishing platforms, they get paid some price that I call fair and modest per paper. So by fair, I mean that if they need some money and some work to do the publishing, so to host the website, to pay the person who is in charge of checking that the forms have been signed, that getting a DOI and so on, then of course someone should pay them. We are not asking people to give away money, but the price should be fair in the sense that it respects the real costs. So this is not really something for a for-profit business. I mean, we should pay for the cost and not more. And the price should be modest in the sense that if the costs are too high, that's something unreasonable is going on. And I'm going to talk about this later. But let's define modest, saying sensibly smaller than $100, right? Or smaller than $100. Of course, the definition of modest will depend on everyone. And this could be paid by the authors using their research fund or by their institution. Or as you mentioned, there is a state level scheme or a national level scheme in Brazil for paying for APCs, or it could be paid by sponsors. So maybe it's not the author who are paying, but someone from industry, some company from industry, or some, for example, the archive is operated by the Cornell University, and a large part of the funding is provided by Cornell. So it could be also the institution hosting the platform that supports the cost. And such perfect situation that it exists today. So we have evidence that it can work because it exists and it has for a while. So one is, for example, Lipix, which is the Schloss Dachstuhl publishing. These are all links, so I will send the PDF later and people can click. Lipix used to be funded by the German government until some commercial publishers sued the German government to say that it was unfair competition. So it was free for authors. And there were orders by the judge to stop getting funded by the German government, to make it free for authors, and to ask the authors for the actual cost of their work. And so they did measure the cost of their work, and they came up with 60 euros per paper, which is not so far from the $100 boundary image. And one conference that is using Lipix is FSC, Formal Structure for Computation and Deduction, which is one of the somewhat theoretical conferences in programming languages and type theory and so on. EPTCS, which is a publishing system that is based on archive. So if you send the paper there, it will be, you get a review system and so on. And then it's hosted on archive and you get a web page that links to the archive of the accepted work. I've used it myself as an editor for some workshop proceedings. So anyone that is in charge of a workshop or a conference can contact them to ask them to host a volume of EPTCS for this workshop or conference. And there is episciences.org, which is actually, I think, a French platform. I'm based in France as well. And in particular, it hosts LMCS, Logical Method in Computer Science, which is a good open access journal in my community.
Gabriel?
Yes?
Just to let you know, the Brazilian Computer Society also has its own open access platform, which by now is mandatory for all of the conferences affiliated to the Brazilian Computer Society.
So yes, that's so this is nice. Yes, and also some institutions have some, they don't have publishing platforms, but they have archives, archive places like archive.org, but more specific to the country or something. So we have something in France called HAL, H-A-L, and I'm mandated by my employer to put every copy, a copy of every paper I publish every year on this platform. So in practice, but again, you have to know about this. So here we are talking about publishing and it's good to know that the Brazilian Logic Society has a mandate for that. So they exist and it shows that it can be done. Yes.
So the question I have is, putting things in HAL is obligatory for the researchers as well as kind of, yes. Even if you put in the archive or some other open access stuff, you still have to put in HAL, because it seems to me a good idea to keep to duplicate things so that you guarantee that they don't go offline. But I want to know if it is obligatory or not.
Yes, so it is mandatory for me to put things in HAL. And I think it's a very good policy that the employer mandates that. Otherwise, people tend to be a bit lazy.
Right.
But there is an option when you submit to HAL to also send it on archive automatically, so you don't have to do twice the work.
Excellent. Did not know that. Thank you. And things, okay, Bruno, so, did not know about the Brazilian version either, so it's absurd that I did not know about it. Thank you.
Yeah, you can have a link in the chat, I guess, but I don't know. So this exists, but the question is, do people use it in practice? So there are some conferences or journals in my field that do live, are part of this ideal world. I mentioned FSCD. Programming is a relatively new conference on programming and programming language theory. It's a conference that is adjoined to a journal, and the journal has an issue every 3 months. So it's a fast publishing journal. And every year, all the papers accepted at the journal get to present at the conference. So it's a nice model, but it's only starting, so it's not so prestigious for now. And LMCS is an established journal in the field that has high quality and is open access and is currently hosted by epscience.org. So it's, we do get the ideal world. Then, the next best thing is some SIGPLAN conferences, so that are under the PACMPL umbrella. So it's a gold open access scheme where the auto processing charges are of $400. So for a while, the ACM charges were 900. And then if you were part of ACM, it was 700. And now SIGPLAN negotiated something and they got a bulk price of 400. So you can sort of halve the price by negotiating. I think that $400 is too high as an APC, but SIGPLAN can pay for the offers if the offers insist. So you have to say that you cannot pay yourself and then SIGPLAN will pay. Using some budget that I understand was mostly built on conference fees at some times where a lot of industrial people would come and pay high conference fees, and so they got some extra money that I can use for that. And I think it's not an ideal setup because someone has to pay an excessive price for the publication, but it's okay. In particular, everyone can participate to these conferences and ask to not pay any IPC. So I think it's a relatively good system while it lasts.
But people don't know about that, right? So, you know, it is very bad in the way that, you know, I had never heard of it until you just told me.
So I remember that this was announced, I think, in 2017, something like that, at Purple when it started. So it's been only 5 or so years, and it only applies to some ACM conferences. So I would say ICFP, Purple, and maybe another, but not PLDI, for example. So it depends. Some conferences have this rule, and some don't. And indeed, yes, the landscape is very fragmented. Then there is ETAPS, that is a sort of joint conference for logic and programming and so on, that is at the European level. So you may know about ESOP or FOSAX, which are part of this conference bundle. And they switched a couple years ago to Springer Gold Open Access. And the APCs, the costs are secret. So the authors, they have to pay a higher registration fee for the conference than the non-authors. But there is no public information about how much ETAPS is paying Springer to publish the work. So it's secret. That's one problem with gold open access or closed access and so on. A lot of data is not publicly available for some good reason that the people do not want it to be publicly available. And I can tell you that the secret is that they pay about 200 euros per paper. So it's less than ACM, which is interesting given that ACM is a non-profit and Springer is a for-profit commercial provider, but it's still relatively high. But then, I mean, it's not so bad. It's better than many places. In particular, if you actually go to the conference, well, pre-COVID, you have a cost anyway that is larger than 200 euros, so maybe you can sort of amortize that. So it's a scheme that is not too bad. And then most other events, most other conferences, most other journals are still in the old model of the readers have to pay and the authors give away their publishing rights or copyright for free. And this, the reason why is that it used to be the default about 20 years ago, and most conference organizers or journals have not felt the need to update. Some of them are tied to an organization. For example, if you have an ACM conference, it's actually hard. It requires some strong will to move away from ACM. You have to resign and open a new conference and so on and make a lot of noise. So it's work and people are very busy with a lot of work already. But for some conferences, it's less clear. Some conferences are like, for example, PPDP, are not affiliated to any publisher. They happen to use the ACM, for example, International Publishing Series publishing system, but they could switch to Lipix next year if they wanted to. It's just that for some weird reason, they don't want to. Okay, and finally, there is a GFP, the Journal of Functional Programming, so which is an important and high quality journal in my community. Until 2021, it was closed access by default, but they would let you pay $3,000 to make your paper open access. And of course, basically nobody did. So it was a closed access journal. And then they say, oh, we learned the truth. We saw a revelation and we are going to make our journal open access. And what they mean by that is that, well, starting now, it's gold open access. So everyone has to pay $1,500 to, I think it's right, to publish there. And they say that we are going to seek a sponsorship from industry. So maybe Facebook could pay to let the authors not pay. So I think that is a terrible practice. And my advice is to stop submitting to this journal, JFP, and same things to the submissions to LMCS, Logical Method in Computer Science, which is also a very high quality journal and is open access. And I will note that the publisher of GFP, Cambridge Unity Press, claims to be not non-profit. So they are non-profit, but they ask you to pay $3,000 or maybe $1,500 to publish there. I don't really understand how that works, but that's it. And so, okay, so then we can ask why is the current status so unsatisfying? Okay, there is something that clearly everybody wants, which is open access. There are some solutions to get it. So it sounds like it's a matter of a couple talks, and then everyone will switch their publishers from the Evil Springer or whatever ACM and to Lipix, and then we are done, right? But in fact, we have been talking about this for years, and things change very, very slowly. So why is that? So in theory, everyone loves open access. So SIGPLAN ran a survey in 2014, and I'm quoting some of the things from the analysis of the results. So 63% of respondents are willing to pay no more than $100 per paper. 73% of SIGPLAN called open access a moral imperative. And then 70% of SIGPLAN respondents say that if ACM did not have a good open access option by 2017, they would move to a different publication venue. And of course, we are well past 2017, and things mostly have not changed. Okay, so if you use the gold open access, it's way more than $100 per paper. It could be a moral imperative, but most researchers seem to be happy to publish in closed access venue, as they were in 2014. And no one actually stopped publishing at the ICM by 2017 because they were not open access. So on paper, everyone is in favor. And if you talk to people, everyone is in favor. And they, of course, people are honest and sincere when they say they are in favor of open access. But still, things don't change. And I think that the reason is that most researchers are not directly affected by this difference, open access or closed access. They live in a bubble where they can access the papers they want through their institution. They can pay for the APCs if they are asked to through their research funding or institution. And so they don't see any difference. And they have a lot of other things to work on, important issues to improve on and so on. So the most urgent things take priority and they don't change anything. And this is not a criticism. I think it's a pretty natural reaction. But that explains why things rarely change. And I think that's the main explanation for why things are not changing so much. And of course, there are some people that have actual interest in things not changing, some commercial interest, but I think it's not the main reason. Yes?
I think there's differences. For instance, in Brazil, there is a list called Qualis, which the funding agencies use to say who will get money. And this list kind of only lists traditional things by and large. You know, they work on the cytometrics things. So, you know, it's definitely, I mean, your most there is a problematic most. You know, the lots of researchers are actually directly affected by the difference. And the problem is that we don't have a calculation, a decent calculation, at least I don't know of any decent calculations about the sizes of the research communities that are affected by that and how they survive. Because, you know, even guys in industry that can pay the fees for the publication of their own papers, they, by and large, they cannot have the other things that people have, because universities buy this whole package of journals and things, but most companies cannot afford that those packets. So researchers in small companies don't have access to that at all, and it's not clear to me what's the size of this community, you know, particularly in programming language, Gabriel.
Yes, it's not completely clear to me either. One different way to phrase it would be that researchers that are sort of in decision-making position. So if you look at, for example, the people that are making decisions within SIGPLAN or the steering committee of ICFP, for example, and then all the people in these groups are within the group of people who are not directly affected by the decision. And this is not a criticism of these people who are doing useful work and running our community and so on. Yes, that makes some things difficult. When you mentioned Qualis, I'm not sure I understood. So did you mean that the amount of funding you get depends also in which venue you published in the past? Because some countries or some evaluation schemes have this. Okay, so this is also, but I would say that this is more related to forcing you to use certain venues rather than open access.
It's forcing you to use the certain, I mean, it's a way of traditionalists keeping their say, because, you know, if they say that this journal is 1A or 1B, then people have a huge incentive to publish on these ones, because only the papers that have Qualis above such and such are counted for their promotion within the university, for their ability to get
So, but if this journal or conference did switch to open access, that would not be a problem for you. So in the sense, it's not really the fact that the journal or the venue is open access or closed access, but rather that it's part of a list that is. So yes, and it's related to something that when I made the comment that assigning copyright is unethical, you could ask, well, if some people don't care, but if some people care, why do they agree to that? And the reason is that the publishing platforms, the scientific venues, have a lot of power. And for most people, the power is prestige. So if you publish to a well-known journal or conference, it's better for your career than if you publish to a little-known open access journal that just started last year and is run by a group of friends and so on. And for other people, it's more than prestige. So it could be, as you said, there is this incentive of being part of a list. So I learned from Polish researchers, so researchers from Poland that working in Poland, that in Poland, this bean counting practices only count journals, not conferences. So, and they are run by people who are not computer scientists, and they don't know that some subfield of computer science prefer conferences over journals. So Polish researchers have this weird incentive of being sort of pushed towards publishing in journals and not in the conferences of their field because of this policy. So many bad things happen because of this sort of metrics and the way research is evaluated. And this is one of them. So there are many reasons why we are pressured into giving up our work to a closed access venue, which include prestige or metric recognition for our work. Yes. And so another question is, okay, why are the author processing charges so high? And so publishers usually, in particular, not-for-profit publishers, including ACM or Cambridge Unity Press, they claim that the author processing charges reflect their real costs and so are fair in the sense of they make you pay for what it costs them to publish the work. And of course, you cannot really agree that people should publish work at a loss. They should be paid by someone for their cost. But when I look at the data, most publishers, first, they provide no financial transparency, so you don't know if they actually say the truth or not. When I say that it corresponds to their cost, you don't see their cost, you don't see their benefits, and so on. Or if they do, they could be, let's say, borderline dishonest about how they measure the cost. They could include in what the figure they give you as the cost, something that to you are not related to publishing the paper. Some insist to do things that we don't care about, most people don't care about, and then they make us pay for it. This includes also some good actors like Lipix. Lipix, most of the €60 price that you pay to publish a paper comes from some careful German editor trying to make sure that all the LaTeX sources of all the papers of the proceedings of that conference compile together by adjusting the macros and fixing the conflicts and so on. It takes a lot of time and they have to be paid for that. But maybe we could stop doing that and just producing individual PDFs and practice, it would be fine today. But it's not how Lipix run things, and you have to pay for it. And in this case, it's only part of a relatively small cost, so maybe we don't complain too much. The Lipix people are very kind, but sometimes it's much more. Some publishers are extremely inefficient, so they will make you pay a very large price for something because they are doing things in a very costly way. And basically, all of them have no strong motivation to reduce those costs because anyway, authors pay the APCs. So not all of them, but enough that to them, they don't really see that there is a problem. For example, when I talk about efficiency, well, ACM did some real work towards financial transparency. And one thing that they report is that the cost of running the DL, the digital library, is $300 per article. And I'm just talking about the hosting on the digital library. So the website that hosts the paper, I mean, which of course has some long-term archiving and so on. So it's more work than just hosting a website. But I'm not talking about the editing, the publishing and so on, which has separate costs. And then archive, if you compare it, the costs are between 7 and 14 per article, dollars, depending on how you count them. So I'm not saying that the ACM is dishonest in the way it measures this cost. I don't know. I don't have the data to tell. But let's say at least that maybe ACM is not using an efficient way to archive things long term, or are doing more things that archive does and that we possibly don't really care about. And so in this price is including things that they could drop to reduce the cost. And the pointer here is an analysis of the ACM budget that I published on the times list that goes into more detail about what are the actual costs reported by the ACM. So when they say that the price for them is 400 per paper for their open access, in a sense it's true, and in a sense it's not completely true. So it's interesting to look at the details, how they count it. And finally, the last part of my presentation is, okay, what can individual researchers do? And I think that this part would be more important in front of an audience to, maybe who is not already well aware of the problems of closed access publishing, but it's a series of things that mostly I am doing myself, so you can ask how it's going for me. The first step is to put all your work on archive.org. So would be my recommendation. Archive is a long-term archival platform, so it's the job of Archive is to take your LaTeX sources, build them, and make sure that in 50 years from now, the PDF will be available and people will be able to learn about your research, possibly after you retire, your institution has changed name 5 times and the website are dead now and so on, but it's still findable on Archive. I think people should submit on Archive as a sort of automatism, as part of submitting a paper. So more precisely, if it's a single blind journal or conference, if the authors do not have to be anonymous, I recommend submitting on Archive on submission. So you submit the paper and you put it on Archive at the same time. Some people write their paper as draft well in advance of the deadline and they can submit well in advance. But myself, I tend to be more of a deadline-driven person, so that's just right after submission. And if it's a venue that requires anonymity of the submissions, personally, because Archive does not allow anonymous submission, my practice is to wait for the review so that the reviewers do not get the risk of seeing the same paper in Archive and being the submitters being de-anonymized for them when maybe they wanted the sort of protection of anonymity to not be biased. So in this case, I wait until I get the reviews and then I put on Archive. So this is nice for access. It's not the perfect solution for open access, but it's already a good step. And as a bonus service, what you get is, if you subscribe to them, email digest for all the Archive submissions. And in some fields of mathematics that really use Archive a lot, it's really, really nice because people can just register to the Archive email and they get to know about all the work that is being done in their field without having to register to the, let's say the accepted paper list of 10 different conferences and 3 different journals and so on. So it's a really nice community service that works the more people are using Archive. And finally, okay, my advice is to write a script that prepares the Archive submission that so that takes whatever sources you wrote your paper with and generate a zip archive with the content that is compatible with what Archive expects. You do it once, let's say at half point when you are writing your paper, and then you can run the script several times every time you need to update the Archive version. Because otherwise, if you need a manual process to submit an archive, oh, I need to remember to disable this macro, to change the bibliography and so on, you will do it once, and then the second time you will be very busy with something else, and then you will not bother doing it, or a co-author will not dare doing it because you are the one who knows how to do it. And then, okay, so write a script that does all this stuff, and just generate a zip that you can use to update the submission. I copy and paste my script from paper to paper, and I hack on it, and it's not so nice programming, but it's very useful. Another step which is more daring, more difficult, and I'm not saying that everything is mandatory, people should do as they feel comfortable, of course, is to stop giving your work to closed access venues. Of course, what makes a closed access venue good and what makes people want to submit their work there in the first place is, well, this collection of high quality research work that they receive. So we, as researchers, we are the ones who give power to scientific venues through our work, usually for free. So when we submit somewhere, when we review somewhere, we make a decision, conscious or not, to empower this venue instead of some other one. So one thing you can do is to stop doing reviews for closed access venues, journals of conferences. And some people ran a website called No Freeview, No Review. So it's a sort of online petition that says precisely this. So if the paper, if the venue is not open access, I don't want to do reviews for it. And you can sign and feel like you are part of a movement. And I would have a qualification. So I started applying this a couple years ago. And I think it's a fairly simple practice. Yeah, one qualification is if you submit to a closed access venue, I think it's good form to accept to review for it because you give work to the conference. They have to find reviewers. So if you submit to places and you refuse to review, there is a sort of imbalance of work that is not so nice. And the second step, which is, I think, more difficult for most people, is to stop submitting to closed access venues. And that includes a bit if you can submit to an access venue that is comparable, that is a little cost to you, little cost in terms of, let's say, prestige, if that you are pointing your career where this matters, or metrics in your country and so on. So there are many ways why you are not free, perfectly free to choose the venue. And the idea is not to ask people to sacrifice themselves, but to at least, when there is a comparable alternative, favor the open access venue. And okay, of course, that only can work if you are part of a sub-community that has enough open access venues. If you are in a fully closed access community and you're trying to do that, well, you stop working as a researcher, it's not feasible. So it happens to work very well in programming languages, and I think in logic probably as well, but some of our colleagues are not as fortunate, and it's not a judgment if they don't do that. Yes, and I should say that when there are several co-authors, so I work with other people, there is a discussion about where to submit, and I will say, well, I prefer to favor open access venues, but sometimes we decide as a group of co-authors to still submit to a closed access venue, and I don't, I make my preference clear, but then sometimes there is a consensus in the other direction, and we go for it, and I think it's fine. Yeah. Of course, these decisions, they have to be taken in a consensual way among co-authors, and sometimes you do things differently. Some people have very strong opinion about, for example, the idea of not reviewing, but in my experience, it's rather reasonable. You still get review work to do. And also, it's interesting that it gives you a way to discuss this open access thing. Whenever I get a submission request from a closed access venue, I reply kindly to the request that unfortunately, it's sort of against my policy. And I think that it's useful to give some feedback to people, and that it gets given into interesting discussion. It gives a sense to the venues also that they might have to do something about this open access thing and so on. And which leads me to my next slide. I think it's important to give gentle feedback to scientific organizers. So people are aware of an issue if they hear about it. If no one complains, it's not really an issue. So I think that at some point, you have to talk to people about it. So one policy I use myself is that if I see an advertisement for a closed access conference in my community, and it's a conference that is relevant to me at this point, like I would consider submitting there if it was not closed access, I will write an email to ask whether they considered making open access. And sometimes it's not even clear if it's closed access or not, and I will write an email to ask. I tend to write these emails publicly, so I reply to the mailing list where the announce was sent, because I think that it's good to start discussion, but some people may prefer to do it in private. And I think it's important to not do it all the time to everyone, but just in the case where it makes sense scientifically, like you would actually submit a paper there if you agreed with the way the research is published afterwards, to avoid giving the impression that it's just backseat driving. And as I said, yes, the reviews is also a good time to mention that being closed access is a point. And yes, the I think the last content slide is, well, there are some open access venues that start. So, and it's a difficult bootstrapping process. At the beginning, you are not prestigious enough that as a venue, so people don't want to submit there. And there is some people need to send nice work to these venues so that they get some prestige and they get known, and they do end up in this list of interesting places. So there is some bootstrapping need, and it requires that some people do some work publishing their work here. And my advice is to send your work there when it's not too costly. So for example, some people have a tendency to think, well, you are an established researcher, so you don't care about prestige anymore, and you could submit to, let's say, the programming conference if there is a problem. Well, it depends. Maybe actually the main author of the publication is a young PhD student, and they will get judged at the end of their PhD on the prestige of the publication they got during their PhD time. So it could be harmful to them if you pick a less known venue and so on. So it's delicate. There are a lot of factors, but I think that most people at some point, there is this work that they did with an intern. The intern does not really care about where it goes and so on. So most people have enough power and flexibility in their work to, from time to time, go for the underdog. And some people don't, and it's completely fine. Okay. So I'm done, and I'm open for more questions or discussion if you have.
Thank you very much, Gabriel. That was really very good. Kind of.
Very much, Gabriel. Okay, really. So now we have time for discussion, Valeria.
Yeah. No, I think it's this fantastic presentation way of putting all this different threads together. I totally agree with you at the end that, you know, you have to think about the young people and where they are sending their first work, since that sometimes determines what will happen later. You know, I'm good on this stuff. You know, I've been in the program committee of LMCS since the beginning, and I was thinking, I think I'm a member of four different open access journals: TAC, LMCS, IFCOLOG, and Compositionality. So kind of, you know, and Compositionality is only 2 years old now, or three perhaps. So, you know.
So thank you.
We are starting. So, you know, we are one of those young things that need protection. Young open access place that need protection. But you know, it is difficult because the business of prestige is important, particularly when you're starting. And you know, you said that you think category theory is okay. It's not, you know, it's not okay, because what happens to category theory is that we have all these open source journals, but to be judged for position and stuff like that, people still go for the closed access journals, and you know, there is no nature, open access nature or things like that. So you know, you don't have the big good reputation open access places yet. The best we can show for our efforts is kind of LMCS, which kind of was under the gun kind of recently, kind of when it moved from the Czech kind of management to the French management. So it's not you know, it's not as stable and as I would like it to be, at least.
I have a question about this. So when we discuss open access in the community, sometimes people say, so basically, you have to know that these open access journals that rely on a lot of work from volunteers. And I think this is true. And by the way, thank you for participating to LMCS. But I have the impression that sometimes that actually the closed access venues also rely on a lot of work from the community, and I'm not sure there is such a difference between the two worlds. Do you have some impression on that?
I agree with you. I don't think there is a huge difference. I think one of the things that I would like to have more is discussion of how much computer support one needs, because you know one of the things that is important for running journals is the business of having a system remind you when reviewers didn't come back, when editors didn't accept or not accept to edit a submission, you know, all the bureaucratic things that before we counted on, and even still in the closed world access, you still count on secretaries to kind of remind people of things, and that nowadays we have automatized systems, but they are not very good, and they get people cross. You know, you kind of receive too many reminders, or sometimes not enough reminders, and this is problematic. But by and large, I don't think there is a huge difference between.
So, yes, on this point of let's say submission management system. I found out somewhat recently about GOSS, the Journal of Open Source Software, which is a sort of weird journal where people submit software and not papers. But they have a fairly interesting GitHub-based submission management system. Basically, all the submissions are going through GitHub, and they have a bot. So they wrote a bot program that does the reminders and so on. So one sort of downside of that is that some things we take for granted, like anonymity of reviews, do not actually hold in the system. So people will post a GitHub comment to review, and so it's not anonymous. But it's interesting in the sense that it's a very low-cost system. It's basically free to run this journal, and it was done with reasonable amount of programming and work on the technical side, and it runs fairly well. So it looks like yes, some of the manuscript infrastructures and so on could be redone with less work on the human side, but it's hard to move from one system to another, and they tend to contend some assumptions.
Do you mind sending us later the link? Because yes. I don't think I've heard about that one, which is it, and I should have, but. You know, there are so many things happening on the internet nowadays, so many attempts at changing the systems of publication, right? I mean, I think the other thing that, you know, that, I really like the idea that you'll have only 25 slides or so, kind of with interesting thoughts on how it works and how we calculate things, but I think we need to put more information there, especially about how to, you know, I think we cover several different areas within this seminar, kind of because as I was trying to say, they are kind of, you know, the practices are slightly different in kind of programming languages versus logic in computer science versus logic in general, logic in philosophical. Logic as part of philosophical logic, and our seminar covers all these different areas. I think, and I hope, you know, and I think we need to kind of be able to see where things can be different in the different areas, but I don't know. I wanted to open the discussion to see what other people wanted to say, how they feel about it. I think there's also a feeling sometimes that, you know, that that countries that are not in Europe or North America kind of have a difficult time with the whole of the publishing, international publishing discussions. So I was kind of expecting someone to kind of come up with this conversation, but I don't know.
I don't know exactly what you mean, but I do think it's harder, for example, for research in South America to be part of my research community. If you want to present your work at a conference, it's very long and fairly expensive flight all the time, whereas for someone in Europe or in the US, it's much harder, easier to go to a conference.
And even some smaller things like, you know, a fee of $35, no, 35 euros for something like an workshop in Lix, you know, it's an awful lot of money for a student in Brazil, even in the capitals in Brazil, even São Paulo and in Rio, it's still an awful lot of money. And
I think there is one way that our community sort of fails in a systematic way in this regard, which is that when you talk to people at ACM, for example, that organize ACM conferences, the way they see things is basically, by default, we will ask people to pay, and then we will carve out certain exceptions for people who obviously should be able to get money reimbursed and so on. So they will say, oh, if you are a student or if you come from a minority, or so there is a list of exceptions, and these people, they can get funds. So there is some way to explicitly ask for reimbursement and so on. But in my experience, it's easy to not think about some other part of the community that will be left out by these policies or not feel that they are concerned. So when we discuss the price of online conferences, for example, some people said, oh, it's fine if the conference is $100 because there is an obscure link that you can click to ask for the thing being reimbursed if you are a student. Yeah. And there was this discussion, and I would say, well, actually, many people will not find this link or know that it applies to them, and making it actually free or just $10 is a big difference for many people that we don't typically think about. And I think the same applies for all the parts where price is involved. Like the mindset of carving out exceptions is not so good because it tends to leave people out.
True enough. Well, the other thing that I think needs to come into this presentation though is the fact that our professional societies are failing us. You know, just yesterday there was a Twitter feed by someone who kind of identifies as gay and saying kind of, you know, the AMS, which is the main society for mathematicians, is failing me thoroughly. And, you know, it was a very kind of nice Twitter thread because he was saying, you know, this is a public breakouts are horrible, but that's the breakout. You know, I don't want to be part of the AMS anymore. You know, I've been a member of the AMS since the 2000s, and I kind of, it should be my professional association, but it's not working for me. That's someone called Chad Topaz in Twitter. And, you know, I think something similar is happening to us because both the ACM, I mean, and the Institute of Engineers is you know, even 20 years ago, they were bad, kind of to my mind, kind of, you know, the way that they treated our attempt at organizing things and stuff. And the ACM, I was thought, was supposed to be on our side, but not so much nowadays.
So people have very different opinions on the ACM. In particular, I mean, many people highlight some of the good things that ACM has been doing for the PL community, such as setting high standards for something that were not enforced before and so on. And in a sense, I mean, in my research community, the structure of the international community is ACM. It's like SIG plan, which is ACM. And the people who are in position of power in the running conferences, making decisions and so on, they participate to the ACM. And which means that they are more aware than I am about the good things about the ACM. So when I talk to them, they tend to be more nuanced and kinder to the ACM than I would be naturally as a, you know, excited young researcher. And I think the situation is a bit balanced. There are some good things at TSM, there are some bad things. I'm happy to point out explicitly what the bad things are, but the general opinion of the community or the people who make decisions is nuanced enough that I'm a bit skeptical about people saying, let's drop the ICM and create a new seed plan without the ICM. I think realistically, it's very difficult for this to happen.
No, I agree that, you know, there's good things and bad things, and but, you know, I used to think that was only good things, and now I mean, there's another thing that I do is I am part of the ACMW, the ACM for Women, and we do these scholarships and stuff for people who are not presenting papers to go and attend conferences and stuff. And I have been doing that since 2015, so it's not that I just joined in, but I think, yeah, there are some sides of the organization that are just not very, that have lost sight of some of the main missions, I think. But not all of it, and some of it is really fantastic, kind of, still, so. But, you know, that's what you expect, right? So. Anyways, I think this has been really very nice. Thank you so much for putting up with that. Let's hope that you come and talk to us next year about work, because this sort of work needs to be done too. But you know, it's nice to hear also about the contents. The reason I knew about you is not because of this work, but because of the work in programming languages. And I think that would be nice.
Thank you very much, Gabriel.